very, very familiar with that. Jesus met with Nicodemus, and he spoke to him about the necessity of being born again. You must be born again in order to see the kingdom of God and to enter into the kingdom of God. Jesus spoke. He made a contrast between earthly things and heavenly things. So that is part of the heavenly. He's going to talk about salvation, and he's going to include also the condemnation of those that do not believe this message. For God so loved the world. You know that theologians sometimes will make a debate on some small words. And the scriptures. And this morning I want to draw attention to two of these little words, but that carry a lot of importance. The word for. The word for here is used more than 1,000 times in the New Testament, and it is always used as a conjunction for reasons. It will lead you to a reasoning effect, to emphasize something, to explain something that has come before, and it will reinforce it in coming. It's like the therefore sometimes that we have, the why and the because that we have. So that when you see this word being used here in verse 16, it forces us to go to verse 14 and 15, because this is telling us why the connection between what has been said previously. And then Jesus referred to a story of the Old Testament. And just as Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I would like you to pay attention to verse 15 and verse 16, the later part, for everyone who believes in him, in verse 15, may have eternal life. Verse 16, so that everyone who believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. This brings so much comfort into our life. And I was talking about theological views. For God so loved. This is the most common translation that we have. But what does the so mean? And many theologians debated on that. And most of them come to the conclusion, following the Greek grammar, that it emphasizes the degree with which God loves us. For God loves so much. He so much loved us. It's an emphasis of the degree of the love of God. But also the manner, because some scriptures and some theologians see more the manner in which God expresses love. For God loved the world that way. And we have some theologians that insist on that. So John would insist on the manner, the nature of God's love, with a focus on the intensity of his love and the intent of his love. What is the intent of God's loving us so much? What he wants to do in loving us so much and sending his Son? What is his aim? What is his objective? And it emphasized the greatness of the gift, because it says that he gave his Son so to prove that he loves us so much. Say amen for that kind of love that we have. And then if we look to the next slide, you will see the effect that the theologians has when they interpret scriptures on the Bible interpretation. So the first three scriptures emphasize the intensity of his love. He loves the world so much that he gave. Yes, God loved the people of this world so much. For God loved the world so greatly. And then on the later verses, you will see the manner of his love. For this is the way God loved the world. He gave his own son. This is how God loved the world, for God loved the world in this way. And all of the above are correct because they emphasize the nature of God and they bring the greatness of the gifts and the intensity of his love. So that's wonderful to see all of these things coming alive to us. So we want to be refreshed with this very familiar text of the Bible. Sorry that our decoration will maybe hinder some of you to see the screen this morning. And we want to talk about divine love when we look at this verse. And verse 14 to 16, because we have a connection here, we have to see divine love. Divine love toward the condition of humanity. The lostness or the condition and its needs. And it's called the gospel of the Old Testament, like the text that we are going to refer to. Because don't you think it is a bit strange or surprising that this beautiful text for God so loved the world, that Jesus connected it. He could have connected it to so many texts of the Bible of the Old Testament, but he chose to connect it to this text of number. Look at this text here in number in the Old Testament. It refers to the events described in Numbers chapter 21, verse 4 to 9. Hallelujah. And we see the emergency of the need. The people had rebelled against God, and God sent poisonous snakes or fiery burning snakes that bit the people and many died. And it says that the Lord sent the fiery serpents to get the nation. Sometimes you will wonder, that's not love in this text. But actually, you think a bit deeper, you will see a form of love. Because if God does not change the old nations' directions, they are not going to reach to the promised land. They are not going to enter the fullness of the grace and the beauty of the promised land. They are not going to taste of the goodness of God because of their own sinfulness. So we see love even in the judgment, in the punishment. I mean, you are parents, many of you. You know that sometimes punishment is hard for the parent, but it's sometimes necessary to bring a correction. And you can see a form of correction in this text here. And also, when it says that many people died, remember the context of this. Go deeper on this text, this kind of text. And this text, they've already rebelled. They've already showed their unbelief. They've already refused to believe God, and God already had told them that this generation were all going to die in the wilderness because they despise the promise, they despise the deliverance, they despise the great plan that God has for them. They disobeyed. They didn't want that. They said, no, God. And then God says, this generation will all die in the wilderness. So that is also explaining why this kind of judgment has happened over here. So we see the emergency of the need and God intervening. Because as when the people realize their sinfulness, God never stopped loving us, and God will always bring a solution and will bring his salvation to us. And he says, we have sinned. We have spoken against the Lord and against you, against Moses. And they ask Moses to pray for them. And they knew at this point that their salvation and their healing depended solely on the mercy of God. So they turned to the Lord, because many times they just swore and blaspheme and rebel and spoke against God and against the blessing of God. God gave them manna. We are fed up with manna. We don't want that. And they accuse God. They ascribe God to have evil intent for their life when God was determined to bless them and to save them. So they spoke against the Lord. So now they are coming back to realizing that their salvation, their well-being, and their healing dependent on the Lord. So on the instructions of God, Moses made a bronze serpent and put it on the pole. And if a person who had bitten, was bitten by a poisonous serpent or fiery serpent, looked to the serpent, he lived. And we know that the serpent pole, and Jesus makes it very clear, is a type. In the Bible, we call these kind of parallel texts, we call them a shadow of the reality. It's like something that represents something that is more real that was going to be revealed in Christ Jesus. And it's a shadow of the cross of Jesus Christ. So that story in Numbers 21, verse 4 to 9, was very familiar to Nicodemus, to whom Jesus was speaking. It's a story of sin. It's our story, actually. It's a story of sin, it's a story of grace, and it's a story of faith. Story of sin, they rebelled against God. It's a story of God because Moses interceded for the people and God intervened immediately for the rescue and the healing of his people. And he gave them a solution, raised this fiery person, serpent, and then anybody will look will be healed, will be saved. It's a story of faith because the serpent problem that they were having and why people died, the solution to that problem was not to kill the serpent. And it was not medicine, taking medicine or antidote. It was not pretending that the serpent did not exist. And it was not climbing upon the pole to run away from the serpent. The answer was looking by faith to that. And when they did, then they would be saved. Just like Isaiah said in verse 45, look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. Amen? So that already the Old Testament is full of promise of salvation. The gospel message was in the Old Testament, but it is revealed more clearly in the New Testament. All of us humans, and I think you will recognize that in yourself, we are ready and willing to do about anything, 100 things to earn our salvation, to get our own solutions. We want to be independent. We want to do it on our own. We want to do anything, but God asks us only one thing. Trust in him. That's all he asks. He doesn't ask us to do difficult things. You know, in Montreal, where we come from, we have a St. Joseph Oratory. This is a very famous tourist site. It's a big, huge cathedral to St. Joseph, who was the protector of, I don't remember what it is, but apparently people who believe in this saint would receive a lot of healing. And it's on the mountain, Mount Royal in Montreal. And to get to this cathedral, you have to climb many, many, many stairs. And pilgrims would come there and would climb on their knees all the stairs up. You know, that's a form of expressing their devotions and their faith and their strong, earnest desire for healing. So they are going to, you know, people are going to do a lot of things by themselves to reach out and to obtain that kind of salvation. But God says, you don't have to. I provide out of my love and out of my mercy what you need to save you from perishing. It's free, it's grace, it's mercy. All you need to do is look to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth. Amen? Amen. So Jesus explained us by using this strange analogy of the Old Testament. He's explaining the love of God. He's explaining his mission and his heart toward us. He's explaining how to be healed of our sickness by looking at the snake on the pole. And all of us, if we believe, we can be saved from the sickness of sin by just looking at Jesus' death on the cross. But one thing that we need to be sure of, it was not the snake that healed the people. And you know, later, the people They turned to that bronze snakes, that Moses had done, and they worshipped it, and it had to be destroyed. They turned it into an idol. People are like that. So it's not the snake. It's God's mercy that does the good for us. So the belief that God would heal them is God who did the saving. And we see in that story also God's ability to rescue. These people were dying, and God did the rescuing. God is able to save all of us. If we are here this morning, I believe that most of us have experienced the power and the ability of God to save us. Amen? Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, when it says in the Bible, God loved the world, so loved the world. What world are we talking about? In the Old Testament, the teacher of the law and the Pharisees excluded those who were not descendants of Abraham. So they were the world to them, the saved world, or the world that was blessed by God, was limited to the believing according to the ritual of the Old Testament Jewish law. But that's not the world that God loves, because it leaves out so many people. It's not a limited world. I remember years ago, I was in an island in China doing mission, and we met a lady that we baptized in the ocean there. And she was from a cult, from Falun Gong. And she told us in her testimony that the leader of Falun Gong, who lived and escaped China, in prison in China, was in Australia. And at first, they gave the instructions to all their followers, don't read the Bible. If you have a Bible in your house, you have to destroy it. Don't have nothing to do with the Christians. Don't talk to them. Just believe me. But then later on, new instructions came to them. You need to watch the Jesus movie. And they were surprised. You need to watch the Jesus movie. Why? Because he discovered that in the Jesus movie, the followers of Jesus were so devoted, committed, ready to die and their faith for Jesus. They were so attached to Jesus that he says they will look at the Jesus movie, my followers, Falun Gong followers, and they will be attached to me like Jesus followers, and then they will obey me and they will give their life for me. And you know that's what happened. They went to Tiananmen. And they went to protest, and they were all put in prison. But during this time, the leader was in Australia. So this lady, she said one day, as she was reading the Bible, because she found that her brother had a Bible, and she read in the Bible, because another thing that the leader says, it's okay, you can read the Bible now, okay? But just follow me. So they read in the Bible because... The thing is that he says that he claimed that he had a revelation. He went to the heavens. He went to the heavens. I'm not making it up. That's true. It comes from them. He has seen the many heavens. The heavens of Jesus is for Western people only. And there's a heavens for this group of people. But he was the savior of all the Asian people. If you want to go, if you're Asian and you want to go to heaven, follow Falun Gong and then you will go to heaven. So the heaven of Jesus, there was no Asian because he was the savior of the Asian. And then she read this text in the Bible. Many will come from the north, from the south, from the east, and from the west, and will sit at the wedding of the Lamb. They will be together with Jesus. When she read that, the Holy Spirit opened her eyes, and then she realized he's lying. And then she was baptized, and I baptized her at that time. So that's why we see here that many people, many religions have a limited view. The world of God is a limited world only for us. Not for you, and only if you meet our condition, not this. But this text says, God so loved the world. It's not a limited. And this text, it says, you used to be outsiders, And you used to be excluded from citizenship from among the people of Israel. So they exclude you. You're outside. Why? You are outside. Why? You live in this world without God and without hope. So here we see that he himself died for our sins, and not only for our sins, but what?
Also for the whole world.
Yes. In the next text, for he wants all people to be saved. That includes you, that includes your parents, that includes your neighbors, that includes your children. For God so loved the world. He loved the world so much. And this is how he loved the world so much, by giving his son and his one and only son. So this world that was without hope and without God becomes the object of God's love. Isn't that wonderful to read that? Amen? And then we see here that the Pharisees and the teacher of the law, they were expecting the Messiah, when he will come, to judge the world and punish all the nations. And I had more text, but then I removed some because it was going into another direction. But I just want to make a small point here. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world should be saved through him. And we want to just see a little difference between verse 16 and verse 17. For God so loved that he gave, and here he sent. So it's two different words that want to explain one another. He gave his son, he sent him to a special mission, the sending of his son on a special mission. And that mission at that time was not for the condemnation, was not for the judgment of the nation. So that brings us with one question that I want just to have a short talk on that. Does that mean that there will be no judgment? That everything is cool, everything is all like this. So let me see if I have this other slide. Yes. And he has granted the Son authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man. In verse 18, it says, the one who believes in him is not condemned, and the one who does not believe has been condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the one and only Son. The verdict of any human being without Jesus is we're already condemned. So there's no need to condemn what you've already condemned, what's already been condemned. You're already guilty. I don't know if you've ever been yourself in front of a judge, nervous, expecting. I had this experience a few times, so in my past. And even last year, was it last year? Here, I went to the court to represent Lighthouse because we did not take a compensation insurance. And I was the one who volunteered to go to the judge to represent Lighthouse. And yes, so anyway, we always feel a bit nervous when we are in front of a judge. And you want to hear not guilty. You want to hear go home. It's fine. It's okay. No problem. But we were fined $3,000 anyway, by the way, for Lighthouse. But it was okay because it could have been fined $100,000. So I think he gave us the minimum on that day. Praise the Lord. So the verdict is that we already condemned. But when Jesus came, he didn't need to condemn us because we're already in the dying. We are already in the perishing mode. We are already in the corrupted world. So he came to save. He came to heal, and he came to rescue, because this is the nature of God, not to judge. If you look at all these texts that we have looked, you will see the emphasis is not on the perishing, it's not on the condemnation, it's not on the judgment. It's not that it is ignored. It's not that it is not mentioned. It is, the emphasis is not there. The emphasis is on the intent of God. The emphasis is on the purpose. What God wants to do is to save. and to give us eternal life and not to give us condemnation. Me, I always, even though I know this text so much like you, I'm always refreshed, and it does me good, and it comforts me, and it gives me hope for eternity. And it keeps reminding me that this world is not my home, and that we are not going to spend our eternity here. We're going somewhere else. We're going in to continue to live in God's. We have received eternal life. Now, please get that thought in your mind, in your heart this morning. Eternal life. Do you have eternal life now? I mean, do you live in the eternal life nature? According to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, you are now in the earthly nature, and you carry the glory or the reflection of that nature, the earthly, the mortal. That is what we have. Our body is mortal. I was reminded of that last December. You remember when I was taken emergency in Queen Elizabeth Hospital? I was reminded of that, of the humanity, the mortality of ourselves. And every time we go to a funeral home, every time we have a loved one who is sick or, you know, we worry and we think about that. But our emphasis this morning is on eternal life. Wow, I feel so good just to know that. I don't understand what eternal life is, how it happens, how we go from the earthly to the eternal. I just don't get it. I'm not ready yet. My mind is not big enough to understand how it works. This what Jesus is talking to Nicodemus about, the heavenly things. We are not there yet. We grasp some glimpse of it, but we don't get the whole thing. But we know that eternal life trumps over the perishing. This text is not about the perishing. It's about the salvation, the love of God, and the intent of God. But there will be a judgment. And a further text that I removed from my sermon said that those who do not believe my word, I am not the one who condemn them. But my words that they have heard will be the one that will judge them on that day. That's from the Gospel of John somewhere else. So it will come in another way, another form. The one who believes in him is not condemned. But actually, I was thinking about that. There is a judgment. There is a judgment that takes place in this one. The innocent one becomes the condemned. He takes our place. There is a verdict. We are acquitted. We are being saved if we believe in Jesus. There is a judgment being there. When you believe, there is a judgment. You are declared not guilty. You are acquitted. The judge says, okay, fine. It's okay, not guilty. Because someone else has taken the place for you. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to talk this morning, this week we've been talking about superheroes, and I want to point out some qualities of Jesus Christ and show the heroism of the Son of Man. And we talked about the greatness of the gift of Jesus Christ. First of all, Jesus foresaw in advance all the events leading to the cross. The torture, the shame, the spitting, the bruises of his body, the agony of his death. And his death was voluntary. And his death was necessary. I want you to pay attention to go quickly over this list here. Jesus spoke of his flesh given for the life of the world. He announced the horror of his death to the inner circle on the evening before his transfiguration, exciting their vigorous remonstrance. They just says, no, Lord. And that's when Peter says, no, you are not going. And Peter, Jesus rebuked Peter. Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem, knowing that his hour had come. He described the good shepherd as giving his life for the sheep. He accepted the gift of Mary's love for his burying. His last words were full of similar reference, like, there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for his friends. He went to meet the group led by Judas after the meal. He says, okay, let's go. They sang the Psalms and they went to the garden knowing what was coming. He knew all of this and yet he went. So that's why I want to talk about the heroism of the Lord Jesus Christ. And at the end of the public ministry, some Greek came to seek Jesus and ask him some questions. And in an answer, Jesus insisted again that the Son of Man would be lifted up. And he added to that a prophetic announcement to this of the effect that him being lifted up on the earth would have on our hearts and throughout all the lands and all the coming generation. And John chapter 12 verse 32 is telling us, and when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate how he was going to die. Jesus knew it all, and he went to the cross. He knew the purpose. He knew why. It was voluntary. We know the origin of his missions. It's out of God's love. God so loved the world that he gave his Son. And we know the hidden power of the Lord's mission. You know, all the world has been bitten by sin. That includes us. And the wages of sin is death. But God sent his Son to die for the old world and for all of us. Amen? Amen. So that we might get saved instead of having eternal perishing just by looking to Jesus. In the year of 1680, there was a big snowstorm in England. And as a teenager, he wanted to go to his church, but all the roads were blocked. He couldn't go to the church that he used to. So he went to another chapel nearby. And the weather was so bad that even the preacher couldn't make it to church. But in the church, there was a layman, like just an ordinary guy that didn't have any experience as a preacher. So he just spoke the word of God, and he read the text from Isaiah 45, verse 22. Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. And this youth had grandparents and parents who were Christian, but he was struggling with his faith, and he didn't have assurance of eternal life. But this man, who didn't know how to preach, was repeating the text over and over again. And at one point he says, a man doesn't need to go to college to learn to look. Anyone can look. A child can look. Then he turned to the teenager who was sitting there. Young man, you look very miserable. Young man, look to Jesus Christ. And this young man, by faith, that day, received Jesus Christ, became one of the most famous preacher in the whole world of all times. Charles Spurgeon was saved on that day by looking unto Jesus. And he was so touched by the reference of this text to the serpent, the bronze serpent, that you look to the bronze serpent, that in all of his publication, and we know that Spurgeon has thousands of pieces of books and literatures, he has made a carving or an emblem on all of his publication of the bronze serpent, look unto Jesus. There is a big difference between perishing and having eternal life and faith in Jesus Christ.